Surgical anatomy. A comprehensive understanding of the anatomy of the neck is critical before undertaking surgical procedures on the thyroid. Figure 1-1 demonstrates key anatomic structures that must be considered with thyroidectomy. Figure 1-2 demonstrates the relationship of the thyroid gland with the underlying trachea and esophagus, and also demonstrates the usual anatomic location for the recurrent laryngeal nerve in the tracheoesophageal groove. The indications for thyroid resection include the following: a solitary thyroid nodule, usually with fine needle aspiration, FNA, indicative of a suspicious lesion or cancer; a multinodular goiter with continued enlargement and symptoms ranging from dysphagia, choking, pain, or cosmetic concerns; occasionally hyperthyroidism, particularly if radioiodine ablation or antithyroid medications are contraindicated. Thyroid resections range from lobectomy and ismusectomy, subtotal thyroid resection, or total thyroidectomy. Decisions regarding the extent of resection are operator dependent and can be controversial. Operative steps 1. Incision. Proper positioning of the patient is critical for adequate exposure of the thyroid gland. This is normally accomplished by hyperextension of the neck using a rolled sheet between their shoulder blades. The head is then supported with a foam rubber donut-shaped ring. In addition, the patient is placed in the semi-erect, semi-Fowler position, figure 1-3. The incision must be carefully planned to allow optimal access to the thyroid gland, as well as to provide a cosmetically acceptable scar. The incision line is normally approximately 2 finger breadths above the sternal notch, placed to conform to Langer's lines. The incision should be symmetrical and extend equidistant from the midline and have a gentle upward curve. Some surgeons use a heavy silk suture to outline the incision site by compressing the suture on the neck. Figure 1-4. The incision extends through the subcutaneous tissue. The platysma muscle is divided using the electric artery. Figure 1-5. Flaps are then mobilized superiorly and inferiorly using the cautery, as well as blunt dissection, just deep to the platysma muscle. The superior flap is extended to the level of the thyroid cartilage, and the inferior flap extends to the clavicular heads and suprasternal notch. Figure 1-6. A Mehorna retractor is used to retract the skin flaps. The dissection then proceeds in the midline raphe, which provides a bloodless plane for the separation of the strap muscles. Figure 1-7. Continuing in the midline, the loose pretracheal fascia is incised using sharp dissection or the electric artery. Figure 1-8. The thyroid lobe is further exposed by mobilizing the strap muscles away from the lobe using a combination of sharp and blunt dissection. Figure 1-9. A small Richardson retractor is then placed under the strap muscles, retracting them laterally. Figure 1-10. Occasionally, for large bulky thyroid lesions, better exposure of the thyroid lobe can be obtained by dividing the strap muscles, which are then approximated at the end of the procedure. If transection of the strap muscles is necessary, this should be performed supraorally to minimize denervation, because both of these muscle groups are innervated from a caudal direction through the anser hypoglossi nerves. Figure 1-11. The thyroid lobe is grasped with Babcock forceps, shown, and retracted gently toward the midline to expose the middle thyroid vein, which is ligated using either 3-0 or 4-0 silk suture and divided. This allows further mobilization of the lobe and identify cation of the parathyroid glands, as well as the recurrent laryngeal nerve. Figure 1-12. The thyroid gland is re-grasped with the Babcock clamp and retracted downward to expose the superior pole vessels, including the branches of the superior thyroid artery. The external branch of the superior laryngeal nerve courses along the cricothyroid muscle just medial to the superior pole vessels. Therefore, to avoid injuring this nerve, which controls tension of the vocal cords, the superior pole vessels are divided individually as close as possible to the thyroid gland. Figure 113. Next, the Babcock clamp is repositioned to grasp the thyroid lobe so that the inferior thyroid veins can be exposed and ligated as they enter the thyroid gland. Occasionally, a venous plexus, i.e., thyroidectomy, is noted in the midline position over the trachea and entering the isthmus. These vessels are likewise carefully ligated and divided, avoiding injury to the trachea. Figure 114. As the thyroid lobe is retracted medially, gentle dissection is performed to expose the parathyroid glands, inferior thyroid artery, and recurrent laryngeal nerve. The recurrent nerve usually passes behind the inferior thyroid artery in the tracheoesophageal groove but can occasionally lie anterior to the artery. The nerve is best found by careful dissection just inferior to the inferior thyroid artery, figure 115. At this point, the nerve can then be traced upward and its position in relation to the thyroid can be determined. Parathyroid glands that lie on the thyroid surface can be mobilized with their vascular supply and thus preserved, figure 116. The branches of the inferior thyroid artery are divided at the surface of the thyroid gland and individually ligated using 3-0 or 4-0 sutures. The connective tissue, ligament of Berry, which tethers the thyroid gland to the tracheal rings, is then carefully divided by sharp dissection. There are usually several small accompanying vessels, which must be individually ligated after careful dissection, because the recurrent nerve is closest to their thyroid at this point and most vulnerable. Division of the ligament allows the thyroid to be mobilized medially. Figure 117. Dissection of the thyroid from the trachea can then be performed with the electric cautery by division of the loose connective tissue between the structures. Figure 118. If lobectomy is indicated, then the isthmus is clamped using a cocker or tonsil clamp. Figure 119. A. Divided and oversewn with an interlocking continuous 3-0 viral suture. Figure 119. B. If total thyroidectomy is indicated, the operation is continued in a similar fashion on the other side to remove the thyroid gland in toto, figure 120, a, and to preserve both their parathyroid glands and the recurrent laryngeal nerves, figure 120, b. Once resection is completed and hemostasis is ensured, closure is performed by FIRST reapproximating the strap muscles at the midline using interrupted 3-0 viral sutures, figure 122. The platysma muscle is likewise reapproximated using interrupted 3-0 viral sutures. Figure 123. Finally, the skin is reapproximated with a subcuticular stitch of 4-0 monocrural suture. Figure 124. Postoperative care, although once routinely placed after thyroid resection, drains are seldom indicated. One of the most immediate postoperative complications can be wound hematoma, which occurs in a small percentage of patients. It is more common in those patients who are taking anticoagulant medications or non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs, NSAIDs, or who have had total thyroidectomy. A small hematoma in this location can severely compromise respirations and should be immediately evacuated either in the operating room or, if this is not possible, at their bedside. Injury of the recurrent laryngeal nerve can lead to hoarseness. Bilateral injury of the recurrent laryngeal nerves may result in paralysis of both vocal cords, which would require reintubation and possibly tracheostomy. Postoperative hypoparathyroidism is usually a transient phenomenon that is relatively rare, but occurs more often after total thyroidectomy. Calcium replacement and possibly vitamin D may be required to maintain adequate serum calcium levels. In an uncomplicated thyroid lobectomy, patients may be discharged on the same day as surgery. The most dreaded complication of thyroid resection is damage to the recurrent laryngeal nerve. It is imperative to identify the nerve throughout its course in the neck to avoid injury. During thyroidectomy, the recurrent laryngeal nerve is at greatest risk of injury at their ligament of Berry, during ligation of branches of the inferior thyroid artery, or at their thoracic inlay. In most patients, the dissection can be carried out entirely through the cervical incision. In the rare patient, a partial median sternotomy may be required for anterior mediastinal lesions that cannot be safely mobilized through the cervical incision. This possibility should be anticipated by preoperative physical examination.